All right, so what am I talking about today? Well, we're gonna be talking about anodized parts on your classic car. Now, Ford, General Motors, Chrysler, a lot of them had anodized parts on these classic cars. After the mid-60s, they put anodized parts on anything that didn't move away quick enough. Grills, side trim, even the windshield moldings and back glass moldings on a lot of the cars were all anodized by the mid-70s and the early 70s. Our 72 Mach 1 is a perfect example of anodized parts because anything that's chromey looking outside of the rear bumper is, in fact, anodized aluminum. So what I'm going to talk to you about today is A, how to remove the anodizing in the safest way possible, and then B, we're going to also be talking about just how to polish them out to make them look like anodized parts but not actually be anodized. Save you a little bit of money. I have a confession to make. Sometimes it is better to just go ahead and buy the reproduction part and get it over with. And when I'm making that kind of a phone call, I'm calling the guys at National Parts Depot. They stock parts for Chevy, Ford, and Mopar. They have four convenient locations around the United States. They have a location in Ocala, Florida. They have a location in Charlotte, North Carolina. They have a location in Detroit, Michigan. And they have a location in Los Angeles, California. Parts will be to you within 3 to 4 business days inside the continental United States. What's not to like? They even have a website. If you're overseas and you don't want to make a phone call to them, you can actually order your parts from their online site. It's great. I like the guys at National Parts Depot. It's one of the reasons we work so much with them. They're great to work with. You should give them a call and try them out. I have everything that I've worked on so far. And this is basically all the stuff that you're gonna need to do this kind of work. First thing I'm gonna talk about is what I use to make this happen. I use the Easy Off Heavy Duty. The real important thing with this is not so much Easy Off, it's the fact of does it have sodium hydroxide, AKA lye, in it. The lye is what is going to take and reduce the anodizing and pull it off. If you get an oven cleaner that doesn't have lye in it, you're going to have a problem. The next thing I'm going to say about that is this stuff is hypercaustic. It's really bad juju for your health if you ingest it. If you get it on your skin, it's not good. If you get it in your eyes, you're done. So I recommend a pair of safety goggles, some really nice rubber gloves, and a respirator when you're working with this. Even if you're working with it outside, you really want to have a respirator because you can, from the fumes that are floating around after you spray this stuff, ingest it. And brother, you will not be happy after ingesting the material. But what I will say is it works a treat. Probably my favorite way to clean anodizing off of classic car parts is the use of sodium hydroxide or lye in something like our friend Easy Off Oven Cleaner. All right, so why do I use this stuff right here whenever I'm going in and I'm taking the anodizing off of my aluminum parts? Simply put, lye is a great way to get rid of the anodizing and leave the surface of the aluminum in a pretty decent condition. And this is the best delivery product I've seen for putting the lye on there. If you go and buy like a Red Devil lye or something, you're gonna have to learn how to mix that so that you don't basically reduce this to a pile of ash, because it will eat through the aluminum post-haste. Our OT member Bill actually took a pan one day, he was working with lye, Lord only knows why, and he put the lye in the bottom of an aluminum saucepan and, well, the bottom just basically disappeared. So, this delivery works the best of any of those kind of things. You can strengthen your delivery with straight lye and mix it up and do all the chemist stuff. I'm too stupid for that. I'm just going to use the Easy Off Heavy Duty. Now, I'm going to talk about other methods right now that you can do to do this, and I'm going to say this. This is by far the most fun way to do it, and I will say why now. Because this, I put it on here and I walk away for an hour. I come back, the anodizing is pulled off, and I can go about my business of cleaning and polishing everything. If you go in and you do a mechanical removal method like sanding or glass bead blasting, you're going to be at that for at least an hour, maybe more, and trying to get it out of some of these smaller crevices around the headlight doors and things like that, it'll be a nightmare. I've done both methods. Easy off is the easiest way to do this. There are some cons. The fact that you have to basically insulate yourself from the product, or you will, you know, ingest it into your lungs. You may get it in your eyes. But as far as a way to clean the aluminum down, in my opinion, only way to go. Okay, some of the tools that you're going to use when you're working on trim stuff. If it's a grill, it's on the front of a car. 9 chances out of 10, you're going to have some rock dings. You're probably going to have some dingles and dents in the headlight door. I have already worked this particular headlight door a little bit, and I'm terrible at it, and I know that, so that's why I bought the other grill. But what I'm going to show you is this. Some of these things you will use a lot, and some of them you won't use much at all. All three of these little bitty anvils I got from Eastwood years and years ago. I bought one set of trim hammers, and I got this anvil, and then I bought another trim hammer setup, and I got this anvil. So these you will use occasionally. I find myself not getting involved with the anvils as much as I am with my hammers. Now, I got two different trim hammers here from the guys at Eastwood. Both of these are pretty cool for doing the pinking work that you're going to be doing on here. I like this one because it has a flat, small bevel on the back side of it. One thing I will tell you about using this one is these two edges right here, you can go in and really damage your aluminum to where you have to sand out the pimple that you put in it if you're not real careful. This is an acquired art. This is not something that I'm saying you can do like right away. Now, these two things can be your best friend or your worst enemy whenever you're doing the trim work on these cars, because you can damage the stuff to where it's not even usable anymore. I've done that to a couple of pieces on the truck and other cars that I've worked on in the past. Be real careful. You can really mess things up. So what I would tell you is try to find the best used stuff that you can for what you're doing. If you get in a position where you can't find anything, you can send your grill out. There are guys in the United States that are extremely good at fixing and repolishing your grills for you. You're just going to have to spend the money to make that happen. All right, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to basically use everything in this part of the table and a couple of my hammers. Your first order of business when you're working on this is to really look your parts over and see what you've got. This headlight door, quite frankly, is just not usable on the truck because it's actually been kinked over. Now, I'm sure there's places in the world that can go in and make that better and fix the problem, but this isn't one of them. So what I did is I just bought another grill. I picked up a grill fairly reasonably, and eventually what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through and do what I'm doing here over the entire grill on the 72F100. But what I want to show you is basically some of the things that I do when I'm looking at this for work. This door is actually pushed forward this way and on an angle, so the bend is really right here. And what you would want to do is to go back and forth, putting this thing on, taking it off, putting it on, taking it off until you get a nice set. This edge isn't so bad, but it's off a little bit too. Okay, I'm going to pull both of these in here. Now, this one is in actually pretty good shape. You could use this headlight door if you were so inclined. So you can see the bends on these and the problem that we've got going on. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to use the nasty one to show you some of the hammering stuff that you can do. But what I'm going to show you is if you're going to work this stuff, a lot of times you can look at it from the backside and see where you have a raised section in it. Like say there was a push dent here. Again, I'm not using this, but I'm going to give you an idea what I'm talking about with using your hammers and what can happen if you're not careful. I'm not hitting this super hard. I'm letting the hammer do all the work. I'm way back on my handle. I've already pulled that out, so now I'm going to show you what I'm talking about if you do an offhand strike on this stuff. Now, what I did is I hit it here. That pimple is small enough that you're not going to be able to take it out with the hammer. You're not going to get rid of it. So what you would want to do is to just take a file or something, a draw file, and go over it. I'm going to do that right now. The danger in what I'm doing right here is that you may reduce the pimple, but you may also find yourself going through the aluminum. But you can see where there's a low spot in here, the raised areas in the aluminum. If I rock it back and forth, you can probably see that better. So that kind of gives you an idea how that works. If I were going to go in, I would probably try to take this thing and flex it, to flex it back into shape. But honestly, as badly bent as this is, just gonna throw it away. So what I'm gonna talk about next is one of the problems that this headlight door has pretty heavily, and that's these big, huge scratches. One thing I find on the Ford trucks especially is that they seem to be eat up with scratches. I don't know, maybe the old farmer guy smoking his Marlboro cigarettes, going out in the field and running through barbed wire or something. But these grills, the one that's on the truck, has these same problems. And you can see the scratching in the surface of the aluminum where we've taken the anodizing off. So we know that they're fairly deep. These are not going to come out easily, so we're going to have to go in and see if we can remove some of these scratches with our 80 grit, and I'm going to do that right now. This is not a fast process. This is something that's going to take you a minute to do. If you have a lot of problems with this, that's the one time I wonder if maybe sanding isn't the best thing, because you can sand the anodizing off while you're flattening your surface on the top of the part. But you can see right here, we have a spot where it's been struck because it's shinier here and here, and you can still see your scarring in here from the scratches that are in the surface. So I keep sanding. All right, I'm going to get a lot more picky with my position. A lot of times what I'll do is I'll throw my thumb over on my sandpaper block and use that as a guide when I start getting closer to where I want to be with it. The problem you're going to run into sometimes are these edges. When you're rolling over a corner like this, it's going to be a lot of finesse to get that to have the right sweep around that corner so that all this will have the same feel to it. And you can look at your metal in the reflections and see where you're at with things. You'll notice that our little nick that we had right here is gone, the nick down here is gone. There's still a couple up in here, but I'm not using this one. This is actually one I'm just showing you guys how I go about doing this. So just steady. If you're gonna go back and forth, use your thumb in position. And now I'm gonna move on this to the 320. And we'll go back into speed mode. All right, now I'm going to move to 1000 grit paper. You'll see a nice, dull, consistent finish on here. That's what I'm looking for. Not a lot of sanding scratches in there. Always going to be a problem when you're doing this kind of stuff. Sanding scratches are going to be your issue, because when you're trying to make these curves, go around the corners on these, anything that's to do with the grill, you're going to have a problem with that. And you might be wondering, well, what about the rest of this? Because you've spent an awful lot of time at this point. And yes, you will. But particularly if you're doing a grill section, because you have this plus the center section of the grill and all the individual little louvers, you might be better served at some point to go in and do something with a sanding device. But if you're doing a jitterbug sander or you're doing a DA, all of those have rotation to them. They're going to put a rotation into your work. So unless you have something that can provide a straight sanding pattern, you're just going to have to do a lot of hand sanding on it. And most people are not going to have the tools to do that. So, you know, you could probably put it on a buffing wheel like the one I've got back behind me that we got from Eastwood, and put the sanding discs on there and sand it. But you're gonna have to be real careful because you can go too far too fast and end up wrecking the piece anyway. And I've also had it where I've used that before and thrown it into the wall. And had to go buy another piece of aluminum. Now we're on to the 1000. All right, now what I'm gonna do is I'm moving to 2500 grit, which is what this is. And I'm gonna be using a mixture of about 32 ounces of water with a tablespoon of Dawn in it. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna spray it down with a water solution and then start sanding it with a 2500. That basically just emulsifies the junk and pulls it off so that it doesn't stay right up on top of the paper. Paper will last a little bit longer if you do that. You can do that with your 1000 and your 600 as well. It just gets really messy when I'm doing this on a tabletop setup like I am today. And it's gonna be a lot of fun trying to keep this thing stable. You've seen me struggle a little bit with what I've been doing so far. We're almost there though. This is actually looking pretty nice. I will say that there is some modeling in the actual aluminum, and sometimes you're gonna get that, and that's one of the reasons I think they anodized these parts and didn't leave them a bare aluminum with just a clear anodization on them, because I think that some of the aluminum has some coloration difficulties in it. And you can see what kind of time it takes. I mean, we've given you an example between these, how many minutes there is involved in this whole process, and that's just this section. So anyway, I'm gonna go ahead and get started with this. Now, when you're doing this, be mindful of hearing zipper noises. That's a noise you don't want to hear. And if you get that in yours, you want to take your spray bottle and clean your paper off and clean your surface off with a spray. That's why I use spray on 2500, because you're trying to reduce any surface scratches you may have. You'll notice I'm also knuckling my paper. You can see that I've got these fingers right here are gliding along the back side of this surface while I'm sanding the top to keep my paper on a consistent line. You got a little another squeak. The 2500 will get you almost exactly where you need to be as far as the polish on this is concerned. You just want to keep working it until you get where you want. Still got something squeaking. Squeak, squeak. It's really sad. I wasn't going to put this on the truck, but now I'm kind of thinking maybe I will, just because 3/4 of it is already done. I got so many moldings on that truck to clean up. Now, you're at about a 90% right there. I can see my ugly mug in it, but there's still some hazing down the center line of it, so I'll probably go in and keep working the 2500. The hard thing is going to be on this radius right here. When I get to that radius, I'm gonna have to really work this by hand with the 2500 to get that to pull in so that it looks as nice as the top does. And there's still some hazing in the dead center. Now, hazing that I have down here is probably from the anodization that's still on here, because you remember, I didn't knock that off of this section of the headlight door. I only knocked it off with the easy off back here. And a lot of that modeling I was seeing over here is going away too, now that I'm bringing the shine up on it. So, gonna go back off camera, gonna sand some more and more until I get that hazing off there, so you can see exactly how this thing's gonna look when we're done with it. Sandpaper. All right, this is not what I would do for final. There's a little bit more work I could do to take some of the filminess, or I guess the dullness out of here, but you run into a problem because the more of that you do, the less like the original anodizing it looks. Like I said, the anodizing is about 90 to 95% of a chrome finish. And so right here, we're a little bit over that. I won't go any further. Now, another thing that a lot of guys will tell you when they're doing this is they'll go in and clear coat it. Why? Because if you clear coat this stuff, you're just gonna have to remove the clear coat if you have to go in and do anything to it and go in and repolish anything. And unless you have a lot of good UV stuff, the clear coat can be a problem. And also when you clear coat this stuff, it can be somewhat problematic. So what I tend to wanna use with that is Gibbs oil. This is actually a product a lot of guys used to use on their magnesium wheels back in the day. keep the wheels nice looking and keep them from graying up real bad. We've used it on our 69 Fairlane wagon on the back anodized aluminum trim around the back window of the car because I just don't want to take that off and try to polish it because it's an absolute pain. So what I'll do now is I would go in and I would put some Gibbs oil on a cloth and just wipe the entire piece down after I did all the work to it. All right, folks, that's our show for this week. Do me a favor, go out and like and subscribe to the channel. Also hit the notification bell. If you don't hit the notification bell, you're not gonna be notified when we put a new video up. Generally, it's twice a week with Manic Mechanic. We've been on a little bit of a hiatus on Manic Mechanic, but we're back here pretty quick. Another thing I'd like for you to do is to also go out and check out our Patreon account. We have a link in the description below. We're going to be doing some cool stuff over there. We're working on that right now for guys who are in the Patreon account, above and beyond what we do here on YouTube. So please check that out. Final thing, we have t-shirts, hoodies, mugs, and ladies' tees available below the description and above the comments. So many things to talk about. Check those out. Buy a t-shirt. You guys have asked for them. They're available now. Get one for yourself. You guys have a great week, and we'll see you next time on Autorestomod.